Welcome, friends, to the second half of this one-day holiday program, holiday party we are having here. I hope you enjoyed the lunch, which was prepared by different people with a lot of love. And when food is prepared with love, it always tastes better. I have had that experience always. You give me something to eat, I'll tell you it was prepared with anger or with love. So we all radiate something. We radiate love. And when we are in that mode, everything is affected, including food, including our environment, including where we are. Sometimes we emphasize too much that this world is not worth living in. You better go meditate and go inside. I don't subscribe to that view. I don't subscribe for good reason. The reason is this world is being created from inside. It is not being created from outside. This world, the source of this world we see around us, is inside us. And we are projecting and making a world outside of ourselves. That is why, how can we condemn something which is being created by us from inside? It has been created for a certain purpose. It has been created to give us a different physical experience. A material experience with matter. It's great, it has done a good job. How can you condemn something which is so wonderful, created for our enjoyment, for having a great adventure here? So you can't condemn that. On the other hand, one master says, Antar Bahar Eko Jano Yahi Guru Gyan Bataya. He says, all I've learned from my master is that the inside and the outside are the same. And we make such a big distinction. We think we have to run away from here and go somewhere. There's no going somewhere. We are always here, no matter where we are. We are always here, and the world outside is also here, and the inside is also here. Nothing ever goes away, and we don't go anywhere either. We just move about in an experience that is being created around us. And that experience is so wonderful if we look at it like that. If you look at this life around you as a play, as a drama, as a movie which you have come to see, and you believe that you are sitting in the audience and your seat in the audience is inside your head, and you happen to be, by a strange coincidence, sitting in one of the characters of the play, and therefore you are participating in the movie, because you chose to sit in one character's head. And therefore, you are now participating in the movie as an actor and also as the audience, as the witness. You are the witness and the actor at the same time. If you look at life like that, it will make great sense to you that we have created a great show. But if you start believing that this body of yours is yourself, and you're trapped in this world, then you have to look for escape routes, escape with drugs, escape with alcohol, escape with meditation, escape with going to ashrams, escape by running to religion. Then we try to escape. There is no reason to escape something that you made for your enjoyment, for your entertainment. That is why it's so important to be able to look at this world from the right perspective, from the right position, that you position yourself as an observer of a play that has been created. You were the director. You were the scriptwriter. You wrote all this and then decided to enter the play and become a character also. A good example of that exists in English literature. In the Canterbury Tales by Geoffrey Chaucer, he writes the whole book. He's the author of that story about several pilgrims going on a pilgrimage to Canterbury in England. And as they go along, there being no motor cars or any fast means of transport, they were mostly walking somewhere on carts, somewhere on horses, but most of them were pedestrians walking. They took a long time to reach Canterbury. On the way, to while away their time, they tell stories to each other. They sing songs to each other, like a party would do. and say, come on, now your turn, you sing a song. So somebody would sing a song. Come on, you are a good poet, you tell us a poem. All this is written up by Geoffrey Chaucer. He's the author of all those poems and all those songs and all the narratives. Yet he becomes a character in that story and everybody says, come on, Chaucer, now your turn. And he turns to them and says, but I don't know how to sing. I don't know how to write poetry. He's the author of all that. But in the book, he becomes like a victim of those people. And they mock at him. They say, come on, you must come up with one poem at least. You're a great poet. And the worst doggerel rhyme in that whole book is what Chaucer speaks. Question has been asked, if Chaucer is the author of the whole book, why couldn't he put himself as a big hero in that story? Why did he make himself a guy who was attacked by his own people? Sometimes Chaucer's story, this Canterbury Tales, is compared to the life of Jesus Christ. In theology, when you study, they say that the Jesus Christ was Son of God, was one with God, was one with the Creator, yet he comes here and is with his own creation, he gets crucified. Why did God, in a form of his son, get crucified by his own creation? Why did Geoffrey Chaucer, who wrote the whole book and all the characters, get crucified by his own creation, by his own character that he has created? The answer is very simple in both cases. The answer is Geoffrey Chaucer was not Chaucer the character. Geoffrey Chaucer was all the characters in that book. Therefore, a son of God would not be only one son of God. He would be all of them, everybody. When an author writes a book, all characters are part of that author. He's written them. He's expressed them. He's himself there. So if he puts himself in any position, it doesn't matter. And that's why when you look at this story and see how have we put ourselves as a character in a play where some people are richer than us, some people seem to be more fortunate than us, some people are poorer than us, then you are talking like the character, not like who you are. You're the author, the maker of the characters. And when you sit inside the character and say, I'm not this character, this character is also playing a role with the rest of them, then you are all characters. Then you discover that you are the author of the entire play. And just this discovery, that you are the author of the entire play and all the characters, changes your life. Because then you no longer completely identify yourself with one character in whose body you happen to be sitting. Now, it's not so easy to just say, I like to practice this. Because the moment you start practicing, somebody will call you, telephone you, and you're back to the character. You forget what you were trying to do. So therefore, it's not easy to continuously believe that you are there unless you continuously have that experience of being within yourself, watching the play. It cannot be just a spasmodic event that once in a while you remember, and the rest of the time you are just busy with the rest of the world. Because the characters that you have created have some very wonderful potentials to do things like anger, lust, possessiveness, jealousy, greed. All these capabilities you put into the characters which don't belong to you. But if you think you are the character, they all belong to you. The moment you remove yourself from this act, that you are an author writing this, then these are the qualities you have given to the characters, and they don't belong to you. Therefore, these so-called vicious activities that we do are part of the play. And the play is based upon a simple principle. It's a very simple principle on which this whole creation is subsisting, called law of karma. What is law of karma? Karma means that every event that you create here in the play should have a cause behind it. And every cause that you create here should have an effect after this. That's the law of karma. That means you cannot have something here unless there's a reason, cause for it. For example, you can't be born here unless there's a cause for it. You cannot fall sick unless there's a cause for it. You can't have an accident unless there's a cause for it. So when you have this cause and effect as the main basis, the format for this life, then we live here because of a karma. Supposing we have no karma, we die. It's so simple. Some people say, have I finished my karma? I said, not yet, because you are standing in front of me. If karma finishes, you won't be here. We cannot subsist even for a second here without karma. And somebody says, I want to live a life without karma. No, you can't. Karma is the basis of physical life. It is a principle we have ourselves introduced. We have introduced the principle that the physical life should be based upon karma. And then what is karma? Karma is the same creative power of our mind to create through its creative activity a experience that has caused an effect. It's the mind that is creating it. Karma belongs to the mind. It does not belong to our senses. It does not belong to our body. The body commits no karma. The senses commit no karma. The karma is created, committed, and paid off by the mind. So if the mind thinks something which it considers evil, then it will create something evil. Then you get punished for it, because we built it in our own system that if we do something knowing it to be evil, then we must be punished for it. If you do something good, the mind says it is good, you have to be rewarded for it. The mind is its own judge. And in order to create this good and bad, in order to create this morality, it is using a little part of the mind stored behind the mind. It's called conscience. Conscience is what speaks to us continuously. This is good, this is bad. And how do we train our conscience? We train our conscience genetically, because what our parents did, we say we are also going to do the same thing. And mostly environmentally, that means society can say this is good, our conscience says this is good, registers it, and when we do those things, the conscience speaks in the mind, that's a good deed, the mind says let's do it, and then we get rewarded. The whole show is based upon this. It's a very simple principle of karma. But then there are some very strange connections with it. And that is, karma cannot be erased. Once it is there, the follow-up must take place. I was once talking to His Holiness Dalai Lama when he first came to Dharamsala, and I was asked to take care of him as a district official there. And he said that what he had understood was that if the mind thinks one thought, any thought, say, I want to have a cup of coffee, and there is no coffee, that will be registered there on the mind, and even if it takes a million years to have a cup of coffee, you'll have to wait for it. That means karma is so powerful, a registration method on the mind, that once you desire something, it gets recorded and will not go away. It will stay there. So therefore, it's a system. The karmic system is such that once we get into this mode of living in a physical world where we experience free will, where we make decisions for ourselves, and that free will creates the experience of morality with our conscience sitting inside the mind, and we say this is good, this is bad, we continuously classify our actions and our thoughts, we are laying the framework of being staying here forever. That's what's happened. We wouldn't be here forever. We would just come for one life, enjoy it, and go back. Why are we stuck here? We are stuck here because this framework of physical life was based upon this principle that if you think of something, well, follow the consequences, no matter how long it takes, no matter where it takes. Fortunately, it's an experience that is creating a karma. It may be a mental experience, a thought. It may be physical experience backed by the intention of the mind. But it's a physical experience. And it is paid off by punishment or reward also in a physical experience. It's not paid off by something else. So because of that nature of this law of karma, That is why we are trapped, because imagine how many thoughts we think every day. We don't carry them all out, but they are karma. We store so much karma. It's impossible to pay off or receive rewards or punishment for them in even several lifetimes. What we create every year by way of our intentions and actions, some we carry out, some we don't. We have created enough to be living here for several lifetimes. So what happens to that karma? When do we pay off? We can't pay off that in one life. We have created so much karma. So in one life, we only pay off a little bit, which is created as a destiny for one life. We call it pralabdha or destiny or fate. The pralabdha is made from our karma to have another life, another physical life. They say pralabdha pehle bani, pache bana sharir. The destiny is made up entirely, completely before even the conception takes place of a body. The whole destiny of a person who is going to be conceived in a mother's womb is already completed, ready. And then the birth takes place, or the conception takes place. And it may be a person who is still in the course of his life, first life, and he is walking about. The bundle of karma is creating his next life. And he has completed the destiny of the next life. At the fifth month of pregnancy of the mother-to-be, he enters that body and makes it alive. The conception has been started with a guy who's walking about. He's not dead. He's still alive. It's his destiny has been made already, and the body in which he will move has already been conceived. And yet, the man is still living before the fifth month of pregnancy of that mother in whom he has to come again. He dies. He dies in one body and is kicking his mother from inside. In the fifth month of pregnancy. It's such a continuous process. Therefore, when you make one destiny, one pralabdha of one life, you're taking a very small fraction of the karma that's accumulating. What happened to the rest of it? The rest of it, as many of you know, goes into a reserve, which we call sinchit karma. Sinchit karma means it's gone into a reserve. We have accumulated so much reserve, we could have a million more lives and not get rid of it. So the situated as we are, with this activity of our mind given to us as a gift, with the activity of the mind to do this, to do that, not to do this, not to do that, with all these free will activities we are doing in our mind, we are creating enough karma to be here forever, which is what has happened. That's why this has become an everlasting trap. How do we get out of it? If we say, I want to pay off my karma and get out, you take a very long time. Therefore, that's not a good way even to try it. The other way is, okay, I'm going to lead a life without too much of new karma. I know pralabdha is the all old karma. What about karma, new karma? I'm not going to create any new karma. I live in the will of God. I'll go with the flow. When a person says, I will live in the will of God or will of the Lord, and I will not take any decision, let decisions fall upon me, I am going with the flow, then people do that and they create very little karma. They keep on paying off the old one, but they can't touch the sanchit karma. They're still ready. You can lead several lifetimes of going with the flow and still not get rid of the sanchit karma, the reserve that you have carried. So it doesn't happen like this. It's very difficult even to go with the flow. Our mind intervenes and wants to change things, doesn't want to go with what is the flow. So that is why this is a very big trap. The trap that we created by making this experience of a physical world a continuous one, and we go on from one life to another. And that becomes much worse when we find that the soul has no particular form. It's a unit of consciousness and can embed itself in any form, any living form. Then we realize that the souls have been embedded not only as human beings, as plants, insects, bacteria. They have embedded themselves, angels, gods ruling different levels of consciousness. There are so many forms in which the souls have embedded themselves. Therefore, we don't know what kind of cycle we will have to complete. It may not be human to human, it may be human, we come down because of our karma to other forms of life and then come back again as human. This is a real big trap. Therefore, to get rid of it is not easy. And so long as we are functioning within the realm of this mind, we cannot get out of it. It's a mental game. The karma is a mental game. The karma is stored in the mind, works out in the mind, created in the mind, and suffered in the mind, and enjoyed in the mind. This karma is what is holding us into this lifetime over and over again, different forms. To get rid of it, to really get rid of it, the only way is to leave the mind and all this stuff behind. Because we are not the mind. We are the life force that is empowering the mind, and through that empowering the sense perceptions, through that empowering this whole body. But we are not none of these. We are just using them. If we can just leave them behind, there will be no karma. Soul never has a karma, never will. Soul has nothing to do with karma. It's a mental thing. Only by taking on a mind, we create karma. If we can leave the mind behind, then we can say, karma, everything left behind. To leave the mind behind and go beyond the mind, that can only be done by a pull coming from beyond the mind. A pull that is pulling our soul, not our mind. A soul is being pulled by a soul which is on the other side of the mind, not on this side. Not somebody calling us within the mental realms, somebody calling us from beyond the mental realms and pulling us. What I describe as a perfect living master is a person, a human being, whose consciousness at all times, 24/7, is beyond the mind. And therefore, when that pull comes from such a person, that pull alone can take us, through love and devotion, beyond the mind. Some people are very lucky to get such an experience. They will get an experience if they are ready for it. When you are ready, a perfect living master of this type that I am mentioning, the one who is operating from beyond the mind, even when he is a human being. A person who says, I have done a lot of meditation and I have access to higher levels of consciousness, cannot help us. He can guide us to some extent, but he cannot pull us beyond the mind. Because all the communication he has with us is with the mind. No amount of talk, no amount of lectures, no amount of workshops and seminars can take us beyond the mind unless there is a pull from somebody beyond the mind. And that pull makes us feel that there is an unconditional love that is pulling us. Something that is felt by our soul inside. It's not felt by our mind so much. Only if it pleases the mind that there is something interesting, something pleasurable, the mind goes along with the soul. Otherwise, there's a conflict. We are being pulled by the love of a human being, a person who is operating from beyond the mind. We are being pulled because of that, and the mind can't go there, and the mind is arguing, how is it possible? How is that? And these are experiences we all have. So, if you want to go beyond karma and get out of the trap, you have to go on a route that takes you beyond the mind. There are so many masters today around the world. I have met so many myself who will teach you methods of meditation, take you to heavens, show you heavenly experiences. And I must tell you, all the heavens are in the very first stage, astral plane, what we call it. All the heavens, all the gods we are worshipping, go and see them. They sit in heavens which are in the astral plane. Many of them are sitting in a plane which is overlapping with the physical plane. The overlap of the physical and the astral. They don't take you beyond the mind. We get a good time. We can go to heaven and have a great time. When the time is up, we come back. Karma is timed out. It is all fixed in periods, in segments. For this karma, so much punishment or reward. If you say you did something so bad you should go to hell, in hell for 15 minutes, 15 days, and then you've done something very good to atone for it. Heaven for 15 minutes, 15 days. It does not mean the hell is gone. You first go to hell or then you go to heaven. At least one choice is given at the time of death, that you can choose where to go first. That's your last choice before you die. But this choice that we get, which we feel we have a free will to make choices, this choice making ends when we die and go up there. Then we find the whole thing is programmed and we go through it and there's no choice making. And what we thought was our choice in the physical world turns out to be already pre-recorded, the manner in which we used our free will, the way we thought about it, making a choice, is all pre-recorded there. And once we get to know what it is, it's like a ride. It is like going to an amusement park and getting on the big Ferris wheel that goes up and down. You sit on the wheel and you go up and down. You have no choice. You can't say, I'm now going up or I'm going down. It's the Ferris wheel that's carrying you. You discover that this life is like that only when you go above this physical world and see the astral world and see how the records are kept by which you are made here. Then you can also go higher. There are some masters, even today, in this world, who will take you to the universal mind. They show you that your mind is not a unit by itself. It's part of a universal mind. Because it is a part of universal mind. Just like the soul, the consciousness is part of totality of consciousness. Beyond the mind itself is a copycat of that. It's just a copy of that, and there's universal mind in which this individuated mind is taking part. Just like consciousness is not a separate individual, it is participating like an individuated consciousness in totality. So they take you to the mind and show you the whole structure of the mind and how everything is being created there, including all our lives. Possible permutations and combinations of lives which we can possibly live are all recorded. And there we discover that before we were ever in the mental realm, that we picked up our own destiny. We picked up our own destiny and came for a ride. Why did we pick up such rotten lives? Sometimes we might wonder, looking at our current life, that couldn't we do better than that? What kind of judge were we that we had to pick up the life that we are leading now? But the truth is that we did not take it seriously. It was not supposed to be serious. When you go to see a movie, there are murders taking place in the movie. You don't say, I'm not going to see the movie. There's going to be some violence there. In fact, violent movies seem to sell more at the box office than the non-violent ones. So we go to see as a movie, it's a play. So we come down to these experiences treating it like a play. Only when we get caught down here and don't want to leave and get trapped into the system of this movie that we regret it. Otherwise, what we look at is, here is a life. It has something good, something bad, interesting. There has to be some drama. We create plenty of drama, physical, emotional, and then we say, that's a good life, let's take that. And if it's a repercussion, we have another life, okay, so be it. But in the third, fourth, fifth life, we have the arrangement that a perfect living master comes in the fifth life and takes us home. Fine, all five are good. That's what we do. We do not go into the individual life and say there are ups and downs, because that's necessary to have ups and downs to make a physical human life. If we pick up a life which is all good, we can have that life, but not in the physical world. It will be in heaven. There are souls in the heaven like that. They wanted a continuous period of pleasures and joys. They're sitting there, having pleasure and joy all the time. I believe they're getting bored also. Because if you have the same thing all over for a long time, you get bored no matter how good it is. Then if you are totally evil, and your whole tendency has been evil, you want to pack your life with evil and experience it, there's another place for it, hell, also in the astral plane. There are people there who are suffering because of their own choices. But it is only when you have a combination of these two, combination of good and bad, let you make the physical human body. So we have all come with a combination. And the combination is pretty good. And sometimes when we weigh these different functions, different events that we have placed into human life, we say, why did I put myself into poverty all the time? Then we find that person is rich. He made a better choice. Then we compare our life. The rich man is crying all the time because of emotional disturbance and being left out by his partners, all kinds of things happening to that rich guy. The poor guy doesn't have those problems. He's happy. The tangible and the intangible things are mixed together to create a balance. We all are balanced. If you look from the top, you will see that all human lives, they look so different here, but they have a balance creating some physical assets and some non-physical miseries. And there are some who got physical nothing and who got so much happiness otherwise. So these are a combination on which these lives are based. It's a very good combination that's made. When you pick up a life in what is called the Akashic records, the records mean they are all prepared in advance. That's why they're called the records in the universal mind. In the second stage, the causal stage where all causes are created, where you go to that stage and see which life you picked up, you will notice that your life was balanced. At that point, you can see the balance in the life. You say, okay, less money, more happiness. There's more misery here because of emotional breakdown, but there's a lot of money here. Okay, we made up a good combination. And depending upon the tendencies that you have built upon that mind from previous lives, you pick up the kind of life you want. Once you are here, it's like a cycle automatically rolling along on cause and effect basis. So there are masters who will take you to these experiences, and it looks like that's your true home. The first stage, the heaven looks like your true home in the astral plane. The universal mind at the causal plane looks like your true home. But they are not your true home. They are all time bound. They all function in time and space, all of them. When you want to go beyond that to your true home, and you are only pulled by a perfect living master whose consciousness here, his awareness here, is automatically tied up with that at all times, and he can pull you here, he is pulling you beyond the mind. And love and devotion are the only ways to go beyond the mind. Everything else is only to go up to the second stage of causal level where karma is created and where karma is stored. So that is why the meditation we talk of, somebody wrote to me an email this morning, and he said that he's a doctor, and he is saying, what you are telling us is to do things which the mind is supposed to be doing. How are you turning us into spiritual beings? You are using the mind to repeat words, to do simran, repetition of mantras, using the mind to put attention on things. Attention is a function of mind, and you are trying to teach us something in the mind, and spirituality is not mind. So I sent an answer to him today. I said, so long as we are in the realm of the mind, we have to use the mind. We have to use the mental apparatus. That's the only thing we have here. But inside us, the other thing is also functioning. Love and devotion is functioning continuously. We have a basic love, intuition, and joy built into us. Not built into the body, not built into the senses, not built into the mind, built into our soul. Even when we leave the mind and everything behind, these things are still there with us. And that is why when we are taken above that, then these mental efforts don't work. This kind of meditation doesn't work. But love and devotion pulls us right to the top. How far can you go? You can only go as far as your guide can tell you that a route exists and a pathway exists, and you go. Therefore, your limit of spiritual evolution is really dependent upon who's guiding you and telling you that's the end of the journey. Different masters are sitting there giving you different ends of the journey. But a perfect living master, according to my definition, is one who takes you beyond the mind. Even if he takes you only to the state where you discover you are a soul, you are immortal soul, you were never born, You will never die. You just embedded yourself into finite things like mind and body. Even when you go there, I call that person who can help us to go there as a perfect living master. But a true perfect living master will be one who will take you well beyond that, who will take you to a point where you will no longer feel you are individuated soul, but you are always part of the totality, that you never separated from the totality. I remember 1962, somebody in a church meeting asked me, if we were so happy in our true home, why did we leave it and come here? And my answer was, we never left it. It surprised them, we never left it. The entire experience of being in this world is taking place right there. When you reach your true home, you don't feel you came on a journey, you feel you have woken up to your reality, that you were always there, that was always your true reality. That these were dream-like situations, dream-like states that you got into, one after the other. So that is why this is not that kind of a journey where you go anywhere. This is the kind of journey where you stop going everywhere. If you stop going anywhere and stay with where you are, that is where your true home is. You are in your true home, just have lost the awareness of it. And stage by stage, we are opening up that awareness. When we say going from one level to another, it's opening up different levels of our own awareness, of our own consciousness. And therefore, it's not a journey like that. So when we have a perfect living master in our life because of our seeking, then what happens? We are pulled by the love. We debate with the mind. The love ultimately overtakes the mind. The mind cannot argue anymore. We start ignoring the mind. The love pulls us into higher levels of experiences, and we are very joyful. And if we are initiated by a perfect living master, as we pull our attention, we meet the master inside in his radiant form. Called radiant form because everything is radiant there, including ourselves. Everything has its own light. In the astral plane, we don't need any artificial light to be able to make things visible. They are visible by themselves. Have you ever noticed that you are in a complete dark room and you close your eyes? There's no light at all. And you close your eyes and wait for a while. You can start seeing things. When you look at those things, you can see faces. You can see objects. When you see those faces inside, have you noticed that those faces are not being seen by reflection of any light upon them, but they have their own light, as it were, own illumination by which you can see them. Even in imagination, you can see that. In the astral plane, everything can be seen without any external light. They have the light of their own. That's why when we meet the master, who is the same master whom we have seen in human form, in the same form we see, then we realize that this master, who can be seen in utter darkness, is the radiant form of our master. The first encounter with your master is in the same form in which you see him outside. After that, we both, the seeker and the master, can change many forms as they go along. And they keep on changing those forms according to what level of consciousness they are. And ultimately, in the true form, you discover they were no separate. They were all one. The master and disciple were actually one. The game was being played by the one and not by two or many. But the beauty is that this affliction of loneliness that we have, and we all have it, whether we confess it or not, we all have that affliction that we feel we are lonely. We meet people, we are trying to meet people, have company to overcome that loneliness. But the loneliness does not go away. It looks like people are skin deep, our contact is skin deep only. It doesn't go to our soul. Even if we common ideas in mind, we argue about them sometimes. Then we feel we are not understanding each other fully. We are different. We feel different. But if you go to the soul level and not thoughts, not mind, we are no different. It is that pull, that companionship, which we call spiritual companionship, that makes you feel you truly have a real friend, a real companion. And once you have that experience, even when you reach a state of oneness, in that state which is beyond time and space, the oneness and the manyness is the same thing. Even there you feel that you have never been alone. And here, sitting with so many people, we are alone. And there, just a single oneness, we are not alone. It's a great experience. But this does not happen unless we have had this experience also. If somebody were to ask me, why has this world been created? Why is this world with opposites, pairs of opposites, good and bad, suffering and pleasure being created? The answer would be simple, that without this experience of duality, we could never have the experience of what oneness means. We always need, for appreciation of what we have, something to compare with which is not the same, even if the comparison is with something that is not real. Even though this universe may not look real to you, even then it's real enough to make you appreciate that where there's continuous bliss and joy. That is why if you never came here, never had this experience, and you went back home, you wouldn't feel the same like you will feel now. You will appreciate it much more, and therefore enjoy much more. Whatever we appreciate, we enjoy. Ultimately, what we talk of Sachkhand, our true home, is there is a continuous bliss, continuous joy, and continuous high. And therefore, there's a reason for the creation of levels of consciousness. And we only understand the reason as we go along and see the other side. You will see the benefit of going there after this experience much greater than if you never had this experience. It is also true in this life. Supposing somebody has never seen poverty and is only rich all the time, he will have no appreciation of riches. Recently in this country, a young boy who was living in riches of his father was convicted because he murdered somebody, and they said he doesn't know the difference between murder or not because of his affluence, that he was suffering from affluenza. He's suffering from being rich, and therefore he couldn't distinguish between good and bad. You can imagine that if this can happen in this physical world, imagine the totality of creation, how important it is to have an opposite experience from our true state. And it's all created experience. It's all created to look real. And therefore, we come here, we feel it's a real experience, and then we enjoy the actual reality. I'm using this word real. I should tell you, I don't believe in it. Because nothing is real. If I define real in a correct way, that would be real which never changes. And everything I'm looking around is changing. The whole world changes. Our lives change. Our own consciousness changes. Levels of consciousness, they change. We go from one to another, that's all a change. We go to a true home and experience something there, also a change. So nothing is real then. What is truly real? The only thing I can call real is the experiencer of this change, the one who is experiencing this change, the ultimate self around which all this change is taking place is the only reality. So the self is the only reality. The ultimate self that lives in this world, the world is not real, the self is. The self goes to the next level, the self is real, the experiences are not. The self is real in Sachkhand, in true home, experiences are not. Therefore, nothing is real except the self. That is why they say self-realization is just next to God-realization. Because if you have discovered that self which is the experiencer, you have touched upon reality. You touched upon that which is never changing, always real. Everything else changes. So that is why our self is the seeker. And the seeker discovers its own self. And that's spiritual enlightenment, true spiritual enlightenment of the highest order. So at every moment when we want to search for truth, we should search for the self. Which self? The self that is speaking in us. The self that thinks all the experiences around us. The same self which is operating in any form. Supposing our form changes and we become a different form. Do you know the self will still be the same? The same self will say, now I've got a new form. I often quote the example of a Chinese philosopher Fahin, who had a dream that he was a butterfly. And he was flying in a garden with a lot of beautiful flowers. Now, as a butterfly, he was flapping his wings and seeing the flowers and smelling them. And he says he had never seen such beautiful flowers ever. The flowers were emitting light colors. Beautiful. No such flowers exist in this world. And he suddenly got up and he wondered. That was much more real than this world. Therefore, am I really a butterfly that is now having a dream that I am Fahin the philosopher? Or am I Fahin who had a dream that he was a butterfly? So he told his philosophy, comrades, his philosopher friends there, I had such a strange dream in which I felt more real as a butterfly than I feel as a philosopher. They said, no, Fahin, you're making a mistake. You can't be a butterfly. You should say you saw a butterfly in your dream. He said, I never saw a butterfly. I was a butterfly. I never saw my eyes. With the butterfly eyes, I could see everything else. So I was not the butterfly. Then they said, Fahin, then how do you know that that was you? If the shape was totally different to the butterfly. He said, that I'm certain. I was the butterfly and I am Fahin. That I, which remained the same no matter what my form changed, will never change. Even if you have no form at all, the I will still remain the same. The self will still remain the same. It is that self which is the only reality. And it's discovery of that self that makes us truly enlightened. And from that we can discover everything else. So the methods that these perfect living masters are teaching us to discover your own self is the best method to discover reality, the only reality being the self. I hope during the celebrations of these holidays, you will spend some time on that. Of course, do gift exchanges, presents, have parties, enjoy yourself as part of the routine of physical life. But if you want to take a little message from me, it would be try to discover what is inside yourself behind the eyes. If not for too long, 5 minutes in the morning and 5 minutes at night, it'll change your life. 5 minutes, pretend that this body is not you. This body is your house in which you live. And it has several floors. You are on the 6th floor of this body. On the 6th floor, you have a beautiful room, well decorated. If it is not decorated, decorate it. Decorate it, put beautiful flowers, nice drapes, great furniture, all behind the eyes in that hollow space. And sit in the middle. Sit in the middle and rejoice for 5 minutes. What a beautiful place I am in. And do the same thing at night. Next time I meet you, you will tell me your life has changed. With 5 minutes in the morning, 5 minutes at night. So that's my parting advice as a holiday gift to you. If you want to give me a gift, it's the same gift. If you do 5 minutes inside yourself in the morning, night, that's the best gift you can give me for the holidays. Thank you very much for coming. And enjoy your holidays.